Penguin Random House Canada presents Nothing But the Truth by Marie Henein. Read for you by the author. To my children, so that you will know some of who you were and who we will become through you. Come to the edge. We might fall. Come to the edge. It's too high. Come to the edge. And they came, and he pushed, and they flew. Christopher Logue. Preface. I thought a lot about not writing this book, for many reasons. The thing that kept troubling me is that the relationship between me and my clients is deeply personal. It can't be anything else when you are navigating a person through one of the most difficult experiences they will ever live through. Because of that, the best parts of my clients' stories, the ones I'd like to tell to reveal them and their cases, happen within the confines of our lawyer-client relationship. Ethically, I must keep those confidences. I simply cannot share those moments. And without those moments, I cannot let you feel the fullness of any case. I cannot give you what you need so that you can make up your own mind or ask the real questions. I also did not want to write the usual lawyer's memoir, a book that summarizes my cases with the typical ruminations about each of them feels wholly unnecessary. I've had clients who have chosen to speak or write publicly about their experience in the criminal justice system, and others who have decided that this painful chapter is best forgotten. It is their story to tell, and their choice what they wish to do with it, not mine. Anyway, I hate telling war stories. It's just not in me. But there are things I wanted to say about myself, my profession, about the justice system. It seemed to me this is as good a chance as any because there are so many assumptions and misconceptions about all of these things. The only problem with an autobiography, I learned, is that it comes with an uncomfortable amount of introspection and digging around in places I would frankly rather avoid. Even on a good day, I'm not a big fan of self-dissection. I just don't love my own company that much. Having told my editor and publisher all these unfortunate facts, they still enlisted me to write. I discovered every time I sat down to write about myself, what came out were the stories of others. The truth is, their stories are mine. It is in the telling of their stories that I think you will find some of me. And in the telling of why I do what I do, I hope you come to know me just a little bit more. I can't promise to rationalize or reconcile what must appear to be disparate parts of me and tie them up into a nice, neat bow. But here it goes, my story. The beginning, the middle, and an end of sorts. Beginnings. Prologue. I have a photograph of one of our family dinners at my grandmother's house in Toronto. I was 5 years old. Weekly family dinners at my tita's were mandatory. And as usual, after dinner, my cousins escaped to the basement to play. Not me. I always preferred the company of the adults. Every one of these gatherings ended the same way, with anise-laden arak, our traditional drink, being brought out from my grandmother's mahogany cabinet. I would watch the adult sorcery as they mixed the clear liquid with water, turning it into a cloudy white elixir. By the time the sweet licorice-scented smoke from the arak and the cigarettes had settled over the room, the Arabic dancing would begin. Later on, the pounding, joyful rhythm of the Egyptian tabla would give way to the melancholic tones of the famous singers, Umm al-Kalsum and Fairuz, enveloping everyone in arak-infused homesickness. But it was early yet. In the picture, my dad is standing in the center of the group of adults who are lounging on garish velvet furniture. He is in his element, smiling, his arms outstretched, one leg crossed over the other in mid-dance. It was his signature move, hips swaying, his fingers snapping, a bastardized mashup of the Lebanese debke. The women would later chime in with belly dancing. But at that moment, my father had the floor. I am caught by the camera standing off to the side, arms crossed, wearing checked flammable polyester pants, an immigrant staple, looking straight ahead with a very disapproving look. I have a lousy memory for most things from my childhood, but it's funny that I still feel this moment. And it's where I need to begin. I remember exactly why I had that look on my face. This silliness, wasted time. How could my father blithely dance with that grin? It was the frivolity of the adults, especially my father, that upset me. Even at that young age, I was serious, a chronic condition. And while I was given to excess in all sorts of other ways, the emotional frivolity, the sheer happiness of my dad at that moment, pissed me off. I have never, not once, felt what he did. Don't get me wrong, I've had fun. I'm capable of it. But that sort of fun? Never. There were other things to be done, serious things. And the adults should have had the decency. My father should have had the decency to at least agonize about some of what was being left undone and unsaid while he danced away. But there he was, wildly dancing, enjoying himself. If I had center stage, I would say things, not dance. My mom knows. She tried to console me. As she hugged me to safety, tight to her side, she whispered in my ear, as she would throughout my life, "It's never easy. It's never easy for you. It never is. It's just differing degrees of unease for each of us." Discomfort is a home of sorts to me. I know it, and find myself restless and searching for it the moment I feel myself slipping into any state of ease. The truth is that I feel most acutely when I've pushed into some state of discomfort. For years, I just thought I liked the exhilaration of the new. But that's not it. It is the unease, the challenge of discomfort, that feels stabilizing. Maybe that is what upset me in that moment. Why wasn't my father feeling that? Why weren't any of them? Did they think that because we had crossed the ocean, but held on a little to our debke and our attic, it was done? That we were here? The truth is, I am still that little girl. This is no transformation story. I've gotten a little taller, but at my core, I am still that serious 5-year-old immigrant girl, looking in, the discomfort always scratching beneath my skin, the sounds of Umm El Kulthum and Fairuz, the voices of my home, forever humming in the back of my head. 1. From here to there. To hear my parents tell it, the life of a Cairene in the mid-20th century was bucolic. I hadn't been born yet, of course, but that's how my parents like to recount their life in Egypt. Much of what I know about this, my family history, has been pieced together from fragments of stories that my mother and father have told me over the years, or the stories that my theta, grandmother in Arabic, would tell me while she made pita and lahma bajin in the early mornings as I sat at her kitchen table, or the fading memories of Giddo, my grandfather, that would trickle out while he was sitting in his wood-paneled family room, blasting a crackly Arabic station on an old portable radio that he had rigged up through a makeshift antenna. Anything to get scraps of news from home. Giddo would tell me about how, upon meeting my beautiful grandmother while she was visiting Cairo, he persuaded her to leave her conservative family in Jerusalem and move with him to Egypt. Her Palestinian mother, an austere and uncompromising woman with 9 children, warned my theta that she was going to a very dangerous land with a motorcycle-riding rogue and would probably be killed, or worse. Theta went anyway. She could hardly wait to escape to cosmopolitan Cairo. As Gidda spoke, he would take down the small marble pyramid that he kept on the brick fireplace mantel in his suburban Toronto house and hand it to me as though he were taking me on a tour of the actual pyramids. The pale yellow pyramid that I would hold in the palm of my hand was a reminder of home that a family member...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.